Welcome to the class, everybody. Today we will discuss about the very common instrument which is present in the lab, but most versatile and very important instrument, that is called UV visible spectroscopy. This UV visible spectroscopy is actually based on the BS law function, where it analyzes the sample based on the absorbance of a light reading into the form of a wavelength. So with the help of this UV visible spectroscopy, we can determine the structure of the sample, we can determine the concentration, or we can study the kinetics of the chemical reactions or the biological reaction. So this makes this instrument is a very versatile and the most important the aspects of any labs, particularly in the order to study the biomolecules, right? So before this, we need to study, or we need to know what is exactly the spectroscopy means. It is actually the study of the interaction of the light with the matter. That means the interaction of the electromagnetic spectrum with the solutions. It actually measures the amount of a light, that is the intensity of a light in the form of a wavelength. Also, it measures the light coming through the liquid samples, right? So the spectroscopy is what is the interaction of the light with the matter or the solution. So in case of its principle, the UV visible spectrophotometer, based on this excitation of the sample molecules from the ground state to the excited state. Now this, when the high voltage or the light which falls onto the particular samples, okay, the electrons which are present into the samples, they actually get excited from the ground state to the excited state, right? And while doing so, every electron, they have a particular energy they require to go to the excited state, right? So different samples, they have their different absorbance energy, so that is required from required for the excitation from ground state to the excited state. So this delta E, or the energy that is required for the electron to go to the excited state, they are different for the different samples, right? And these are what the energy shells, the different energy levels, right? So mostly in case of UV light, or the color light, that is a combination of ultraviolet and the visible light. In that case, what happened? The color compound, they require the less delta E, that is the absorbance energy, to go to the excited state. While in case of UV light or the any colorless compound, they require the high energy to go to the excited state from the ground state, right? So the amount of the energy, that is, it is measured in the form of a wavelength by the instrument. So how much amount of the wavelength that is required for the electron to go to the excited state? Okay, when the sample absorb the light that is coming from the light source, it absorb the light and then the electrons get excited, right? So at what wavelength this electron excited, that can be measured by the UV visible spectrophotometer. So this is actually the basic principle of this. So as we have discussed in the previous class also, the light or the electron, they travel in the form of a waves. Okay? So in the form of a waves, they travel along the field of electric field and the magnetic field. So they create a spectrum of a light, and that spectrum of a light is actually having the different wavelengths. We have seen the different lights, UV light, visible light, X-ray, gamma rays. So these are what? Electromagnetic radiations, and all they have their different wavelengths. So when the light which incident which reflect onto the particular solutions, okay, and then it is transmitted to the detector. So this is what exactly the BS law, right? So the amount of the light which is absorbed by the sample and reaches to the detector, that will be detected by the detectors. So in this case of a basic principle, so mostly what we are doing, we are actually determining the wavelength of a sample, that is actually the wavelength of a light that is coming through the sample and reaching to the detector. By this, we can analyze the different aspects of the sample, or we can study the different aspects of the molecules, right? So UV and visible, these are the two lights, okay? And these two lights is actually very close to each other in the spectra, okay? Ultraviolet light, and this is here, it is the visible light. So visible light is generally visible to the eyes because it has the particular range of 400 to 700 nanometers, right? In case of this UV, we have three types of UV light: UVA, UVB and UVC, right? So these, the type is because of their different types of a wavelength pattern, okay? Some of them the high wavelength, some of them the low wavelength. So this UVC is actually, it is shortest wavelength, okay? So it won't reach to the human body, right? They are absorbed by the atmospheric ozones. UVB is actually they falls onto your skin surface, okay? They can cause redness or the burning or the skin cancer, okay? UVA, it is actually having the longest wavelength, and this UVA it reaches deep into your skin layer, okay, and then causing aging and the wrinkling. So these are the three different types of the ultraviolet, right, based on their particularly wavelength pattern. Okay, so ultraviolet and visible light, they are very close to the electronic spectrum. Okay, so mostly they have the 400 to 700 the range of wavelength of a visible light, and mostly the from 400 up to the 200, that is the ultraviolet light range of a wavelength. So to understand this instrument, we need to understand its different components, right? So the components are the source, we have the monochromator, sample compartment, that is the holder, detector and the recorders, okay? So these are the five different types of a particular instrument. They are involved into the UV visible spectrophotometer. Here is the light source, okay, and this light source, and this is what is a overall monochromator, okay. Monochromator is actually very important in this instrument. We will speak about this. Then the sample holder, and finally the detector, right? So this particular part is very important here, okay, and the sample holder and the detector. So this is overall makes the basic layout of the ultraviolet visible spectrophotometer, right? So we'll see each and every components of this instrument separately. First of all, we need to have the light source, that is the most basic important factors of this instrument. There are several varieties of light source are available, but it all should have these particular characteristics, right? Any good light source will be having a high intensity, okay, in the small surface area. That means it should be small and can produce a high intensity light. Should be have a wide spectral range, should give a stable output and the long life, that is what the, that should be a very reasonable cost. So these are all factors that can make a good light source, right? In case of a visible light source, we have very common tungsten filament lamp, okay? This is this. So tungsten filament lamp, we know how it exactly works. It is actually because of the electric current, this tungsten, that is the wire, this wire, okay? So tungsten wire get heated and they produce the light, right? This tungsten lamp, it produces the wavelength of visible and the near IR radiations, right? So this is the most common light source, that is the tungsten lamp. Second is the hydrogen lamp. A hydrogen lamp, they produce the wavelength in the form of a 160 to 375 nanometer range, right? So mostly it is used for the production of UV light, right? Hydrogen lamp. The light is produced by the excitation of the hydrogen molecule at low pressure, right? So the electric current is given so that the hydrogen electrons, they get excited and they produce the light. Third is the deuterium light we have. Deuterium light, again, is similar to the hydrogen light. The excitation is by the electric current, okay, at low pressure, and they produce the UV visible, ultraviolet light in the range of the same as of the hydrogen lamp, right? So these particularly are the different types of the hydrogen lamps and the deuterium lamps. Okay, here you can see the things are inside the glass. These glass are mostly made up of the quartz. Okay, so inside of this there is the excitation of the particular atoms under the low pressure, and because of the current they get excited and they produce the light. So these are the two lights for the ultraviolet radiations, right? We have fourth is the xenon lamp. It produces the wavelength of this particular nanometers, and the mercury lamp, they produce ultraviolet light, right? So what we in both of the lights, both of the lamps, the lights are produced by the excitation of the particular the electrons of the elements, right? So the electricity, when it passes through the xenon gas, okay, they produce the light. And the in case of mercury vapor is get excited, okay, by the electric current, and they produce the particular light, right? So the xenon lamps is this, and this is the mercury lamp, right? So these are what exactly the sources of the light for the visible and the ultraviolet light. For the visible light, we have very common tungsten lamp, and for the ultraviolet light, we use hydrogen lamp, deuterium lamp, xenon lamp, and the mercury lamp. So they produce the ultraviolet light of particular wavelength range. Then the most important part of this instrument is a monochromator. Okay? Monochromator is actually very important because when a single white light it focus onto the sample, okay, the prism or the diffraction gratings is actually resolve that single white light into different color light and passes the single wavelength to the detector, right? That means they resolve, they produce the polychromatic light, okay, and separate that polychromatic light into single individual light of a single wavelength in the form of a bands, right? We have different components. This one is the entrance slit, dispersion device, that is the prism or diffraction gratings, and the exit slits, right? So here we can see this. Here, in this case particularly, this is what you can see. This is the entrance slit, this is the dispersion device, mostly the prism or the diffraction grating is used, and this is the exit slits, right? So when the light passes through the entrance slit, when it falls into the prism or the grating, this is the single white light, right? And when it falls onto the prism actually diffracts the single white light into different color light, that is called the polychromatic light. Okay, this is the monochromatic light, this is the polychromatic light, that is having different colors or a different wavelength light, and that different color wavelength light, which is resolved by the prism, then exit through the exit slit. This is called the exit slit. Okay, and it enters into the sample where the sample is kept, right? And only single wavelength is passed to the detector here, right? So this particularly is the layout of a monochromator, right? So dispersion device, we have two particular components. One is the diffraction grating, second is the prism. Okay, so the prism is actually made up of the glasses, right, in case of for the visible light. In case of ultraviolet light, the prisms are made up of the silica or the quartz lens, right? So this actually is the prism, okay, and this prism is actually resolve the single white light, right? This is the single white light, into different polychromatic light, right? That means the single white light has a different color or different lights which can be resolved by this prism. Okay, here you can see this, right? And the diffraction grating is what? It is actually the optical component on which the particular designs are made. That is the diffraction kind of a designs or a structure is made over the that optical instrument. Here you can see this. In this, right? Okay. So this is what the diffraction gratings. Okay. Here you can see the different structure, right? It is actually for the incidence and reflectance of the light at a particular angle. So when the light source is falls under diffraction gratings, they actually resolve the single white light into different color polychromatic light, and then only single wavelength light will be sent to the detector, right? So in this way, generally the diffraction and the prisms devices are work, right? So this is the prism and this is the diffraction grating, right? So this diffraction grating resolve this white light into the polychromatic light, and only single light of a particular wavelength sent to the detector, right? Same principle is occurring to the prisms. Out of this polychromatic light, only single light will be sent to the detector. So this prism and the diffraction gratings are very important part of the spectrophotometer. So how exactly they work? When the light source falls onto the enters into the system, okay, through the mirror it reflects towards the prism or the grating, and this grating converts the single light into the polychromatic light of a different wavelength, and through the second mirror it is sent to the detector here, right? But only one or a single light, like this here, in this case we can see the green. Only the single light of a particular wavelength will send to the detector out of this all different types of a wavelength. So you know, only one wavelength of a light will be sent to the detector out of the several different lights, right? So in this way the monochromator is actually works. Here in this case you can see this, out of this different polychromatic light, monochromator sends the single light into the detectors, right? Third is the sample holder. Sample holder, it is actually made up of the glass for the visible light, right? And for the ultraviolet light, the sample, that is the holder, it is made up of the silica crystal, or is the called as the quartz. So these are all the different types of the sample holders, or the cuvettes we generally call it. Okay. The thickness of this cuvette is exactly important for the transmittance of the light, right? So mostly 1 centimeter thickness of the this particular cuvette is generally used, and this cuvette is having the two sides which are the smooth and the two sides which are the rough. Okay, so from this smooth side we generally put into the instrument. Okay, and once we add the sample, we have to clean both the surface so that there should not be interference of the dust or the any other contamination. So the both the smooth side has to be washed before the addition of the cuvette into the instrument, so that there should not be interference with the light intensity. So this is what the sample holder, and finally the detectors. Okay. So the monochromator, when it resolves the white light into polychromatic light, and finally into the single wavelength light, that single wavelength light enters or reaches to the detector. Now all these detectors generally fitted into the spectrophotometer, they works on the principle of a photoelectric effect. That means they convert the light energy into the electrical energy. Okay? So mostly we have the photovoltaic cell, phototubes, and the photomultiplier tubes. All these three particular detector devices, they works on the photoelectric effect. That is, they convert the amount of light which is to the detector into the electric current, right? So the these particularly actually the light that is receiving to the detector, they produce the current proportional to the light. That means jitna light aa raha hai, accordingly to that proportional they produce the that amount of the current, right? So they produce the current proportional to the intensity of light which is reaching to the detector. So these are what the detectors, right? Photovoltaic cell we have, photo tubes and the photo multiplier tubes. So all three detectors, they works on the photoelectric effect. That means the amount of a light that is reaching to the detector converts that light into the electrical signal, and that electrical signal can be recorded by the recorder in the form of a digital display, right? So see, we'll see the working of this instrument exactly. So to understand mechanism, when a white light when falls onto the diffraction gratings or a prism, they resolve the white light into single wavelength light which falls onto the solution. That means the diffraction gratings, they adjust itself to send only single wavelength out of polychromatic light into the solution that reaches to the detectors. Now the detector receives the single wavelength light from the samples. So the amount of light transmitted to the detector is called transmitting, and the amount of a light that is absorbed by the solution, that is called the absorbance. So this transmitting and absorption are two things. So the prism, they send the single wavelength light that strike to the detector. Detector senses this and display in the form of a display, right? This instrument, considering its application, it has the numerous applications. First is what, the determination of the concentration. And concentration can be determined is a very basic application of this. Generally we perform into the laboratories. What we do, we take the samples, prepare the serial dilutions of different standard solutions, and then we set a particular optical density or the lambda max onto the spectrophotometer, and then we will take out the readings of the standard as well as the unknown, right? So when plotting the values of a known samples against the unknown samples, okay, so we'll get a straight line, and this straight line, when we extrapolate the unknown values along this straight line, we'll get the concentration of the unknown here. So in this way we can determine the concentration of any sample simply by doing the particular standard solutions and the unknown solutions, right? The impurity can also be detected by this particular instrument, where any the chemicals or the samples which has to test for the its purity, what then we do, we will add the sample into the instrument and check out for the different types of peaks that generally occurs, right? So in this case, this was the pure sample and this is the impure sample, okay? Why this is impure sample, the below one, because it has the different extra peaks. Here there is no peak. That means this extra peaks is due to the impurities generally. So the impurities can be easily identified just by having or observing the particular peaks. This is very important application, that the determination of the structure. Now the structure can be determined by simply adding the solutions into the instrument and observing the different types of peaks. So generally combination of the peaks generally determines the which type of a side group is there, whether there is the saturation or unsaturation, whether the compound has benzene ring or the aromatic ring. Based on this we will get the different types of peaks. For example, here in this case the benzene ring will give this type of the particular peaks, right? And this particular side chain will give this different types of the peaks. So based on the peaks we observed, we can easily identify the side chains or the type of ring which are present into the particular compound. So this will help in the determination of the structure. So these are the three different types of applications. Since there are so many applications, we have kept this only three important applications of this instrument, right? So hope this all clear to you. This is all for the today. We'll continue the another topic in the next classes. Thank you.